Hey, welcome back to the Feral North Devlog. If you're not familiar, Feral North is a game I'm developing about restoring color to the world. And it's still got a long way until release, but it is available to wishlist on Steam, so consider using the link below and adding the game to your wishlist. It really helps a ton. It's been a really busy month since the last Devlog, and there's been a ton of progress on the game, but there's one thing I want to talk about before we get into that. The channel just passed 10,000 subscribers, which is an amazing milestone to me. In fact, it wasn't even 6 months ago where I said this in a previous Devlog. I appreciate the support you guys have shown me so much. I know the channel is still really small compared to a lot of other channels, but we just passed 300 subscribers and it really does mean the world to me. So that video, when I had 300 subscribers, actually went on to get 400,000 views, and it took the channel to a whole new level. It's been an amazing experience and you guys have been so supportive of the game, so I just wanted to say a huge thank you to all of you, and let's get into the devlog. So the weather here in Edinburgh has been amazing for the last month, and it's been really tempting to get outside and not get any work done, but thankfully that's not been the case. I have been able to go out and explore and enjoy the warm weather, and it's given me a lot of inspiration for some level design. And something that happened this month, which is actually a huge milestone, is that I finally finished the first kind of chunk of the game. So the first, I would say, about 8 to 10 minutes of the game, the intro area and tutorial, is completely finalized. You're seeing some clips of it here, and I'm really happy with the way that it's come out. So all that's left now is to finalize the audio, and I'm working with the composer on that right now. But I still think this is a huge milestone, and I'm really excited to get into some people's hands and start getting some player feedback. I've actually been streaming some of the development of Feral North lately on Twitch, and it's been pretty interesting trying to kind of get the hang of this live streaming thing, but I'm still getting my feet under me. I'm streaming about twice a week, and if you're interested in that kind of thing, the link is down in the description. I hope to see you there. Speaking of audio and working with the composer, a big piece of work this month has been moving all of the audio implementation into a tool called FMod. So if you're not familiar, FMod is a way to build essentially adaptive and very complex audio behaviors outside of the game development engine, so in this case Unity. This allows the composer to basically rig up and basically design all the audio exactly as they want it, and then you can feed data in from the game engine to FMod at runtime. So for instance, we can have different behaviors depending on where the player is or what they're doing or what's around them, and you can build all this kind of complex logic without code, all within FMod, and then import that into the game and just basically read data from the ongoing game at runtime to basically drive the audio. So the way we had been working before was I was building all these kind of complex scripts and behaviors to try and match what John had wanted and envisioned. But then this is a pretty slow turnaround time because it's all custom logic, custom code. We have to go back and forth to get the right feel. This way the composer can basically design the audio exactly as they want it, and when it gets played in game, it'll be exactly how they envisioned it. So it's going to reduce turnaround time a lot. It's going to allow us to build even more adaptive audio, and it's going to basically just improve the audio experience. Another big use of development time this month was spent on performance optimization. So I was starting to notice that when you had scenes where there were a lot of color emitting points, so for example here we have 6 birds, each of them emitting color, as you can see from these kind of spheres around them. When you started to have a large number of these, 25 and above, it was really starting to hurt performance. And the reason for this is that you essentially, for every pixel or every object in the world, need to know if it's being influenced by colors. You need to check each color emission point and see if it's within range of that. So the problem is, when you zoom out here, you have all these pixels and all these objects that are very far away from the 6 color emitting points, but they still need to know, and so they still need to check all 6 of them to see if they're being influenced or not. So this is particularly a problem when you have a large number of them, but they're clustered in one place, and the rest of the scene is not being influenced. So on the GPU and on the CPU, we need to know, you know, are we drawing the color to the uncolored world? Are we activating the object? Are we hiding the object? All these different scenarios based on the kind of coloring mechanics in the game. And so the solution I came up with here is kind of a bounding sphere. So what I did is, rather than having to check all 6, I was thinking about this and realized that I don't need to know if you're necessarily influenced by color, but I need to know if you're for sure not influenced by color, which is an important distinction. So if I do a bounding sphere, as you can see from this green circle around the color emitting points, I can say that if you're not within this sphere, then you are guaranteed to not be influenced by color. And if you are within this sphere, then there's a chance that you're influenced by color. And this actually saves a ton of performance on the GPU and the CPU. So basically the first step in any check is just to say, are you within the bounding sphere? And if you're not, just move on, where you're for sure not colored or you're not influenced by color. If you are within the bounding sphere, then we go to the old logic if we check all 6 color emitting points individually and, you know, have to perform the check that way. But basically, by computing this bounding sphere and computing it every frame, it's a really simple operation. It's very minimal performance impact. I can save a ton of GPU and a ton of CPU cycles on all the other checks. So if you consider that hidden bridge there, we know that it's not within the bounding sphere. There's no chance that it's influenced by color. There's no need to check the 6 color emitting points to see if it's within range. Same with the tree in the background there, or the sky, or the ocean, or all these different pixels that are not within this bounding sphere. So if you are within the bounding sphere, it's one additional check, but that's a worthy trade-off when you save all those cycles and all the other areas of the game. So I'll show you here what I've done to prove that this is actually beneficial. So I have this scene here, which was particularly taxing on the game, and there's actually 25 color emitting points in the scene, which you can't see right now because I don't want to kind of spoil what they are. But I added this checkbox here to turn on and turn off the optimization, and as you can see in the top right corner from the FPS meter, when the optimization's turned on, we average about 40 frames per second, and when it's turned off, it's about 28, 29 frames per second. So it's a 33% performance boost. That's obviously pretty substantial, but this is also with video recording software and within the Unity editor, both of which are hurting the frame rate. So taking this into an actual build of the game, I've actually been able to confirm that went from about 40 to 60 frames per second, which is great. So the game is running at a full 60 FPS, even in this most taxing scene of the game so far. And so that's great, I'm quite thrilled with that. Switching gears for a moment, I want to give an update on the monster that was shown in the last devlog. So this is the look at what the state of it was last time, if you're not familiar. So I made some visual improvements to this, and basically made it a little bit more menacing. I got rid of the white highlights, gave it a little bit more of like a kind of jagged, rough look to it, as opposed to being so smooth and polished. And I also detached the lure, so it's a separate object. It kind of looks like a toothbrush in Blender, but don't worry about that. In-game, it doesn't look like this. Basically, the lure moving with the hand, to me, looked a little bit funny. So I decided to detach that and have it animate separately from the hand, so the hand can move independent of the lure. And I think it looks much better. So let's take a look at what the current state of it is. So if I open up this demo scene here, you can see the lure there in the water. It kind of looks the same as it did before, but the difference is now once you've been kind of spotted, it hides, and then the hand moves independently. And you can see that the hand is no longer so like smooth and shiny as it was before. It has a little bit of a kind of glimmer to it, and it's also being applied with the same shading as the world, with that kind of like distortion and dark coloring. And I think that gives it like a pretty kind of intense, scary movement. You can see it also tracks the player now. It follows them around. The movement's been improved quite substantially. It still looks a little funny when it moves backwards, but I think overall the movement is much better than it was before. So it tracks the player around. It also has different kind of attack states for when there's color in the world. So again, you can use color to distract monsters. So here, when it's attacking like a grounded color point, it kind of does a digging animation, which is all done procedurally. The particle systems are very much work in progress. I'm still trying to figure out what the design language of the monsters are. But this is the idea, is it basically like pulls the color and attacks it from the world. I also worked on the animation state for when there's a flying color source, so the birds in this case. So again, the particles they're a bit much, and I'm still trying to figure out what the kind of look and feel of those are. But basically it kind of has this shadowy, dark particle system that kind of chases the aerial targets. And the final thing to do is to then do the attack animation for the dog and the girl, so if it actually attacks you, I want it to kind of pinch you with those two front fingers and kind of pull you back into the water. So far it basically just kind of follows you around, and that's it. So that's still something that needs to be done. But yeah, I just wanted to give you guys an update on that. It's still obviously not complete, it's still a long way to go on this, and the fact that it's the first monster, it's taking a little bit longer to figure out these kind of, like I said, the design language and figuring out how the monsters look and feel in the game. But once this one's done, then further ones will be a little bit quicker to implement. For all the technical improvements and milestones this month, one thing that I am happiest with has to be the progress on the canoeing system. In the last devlog, I showed how I'd made some improvements to the animations, and there was a ton of feedback on this. Some was positive, plenty was negative. But one common suggestion was that I should use a double-bladed paddle or a kayak paddle just to simplify things. I'd actually done some research on this earlier on, and I found that some people in the canoe community are pretty against double-bladed paddles, while others love them for many advantages. I decided to give it a go and just see how the animations would look, and I'm really pleased with the results. Not only is the animation easier, but I actually found the controls are way more responsive this way. And the reason for that is that there's less lag between the player input and the paddle animation playing, since there's no time needed to switch sides. So I created all new animations from scratch, and I wrote some code to keep the paddle aligned with her hands, so that no matter what animation is playing, the paddle is always in the perfect spot. All this got me thinking, and I actually ran a poll over on Discord regarding the input system, whether I should keep the current system, where holding the right trigger does a reverse paddle on the right, and therefore turns right, or go with a more realistic but inverted control scheme, where holding the right trigger does a normal right side paddle, but turns left, the same way it does when you're actually in a canoe. And to my surprise, the results were actually unanimous. Basically, people did not like the current control scheme that I had implemented, and wanted that more realistic but inverted control scheme. So, that was pretty interesting. By the way, as a completely random aside, we've actually been playing some Among Us on the Farewell North Discord this month, and it's been a lot of fun. So if you're interested in joining in on that, there's a link down below. Okay, anyways, back to the canoeing. So you can see on the bottom right there, I added a little indicator for the purposes of this video, just so you can see what buttons I'm pressing on my controller and how it impacts the animation. So as I press on the right and left trigger, you can see that the girl is nearly instantly starting to paddle on that side. And this is because there's no need for that intermediary animation to pass the paddle from one side to another. And so it's way more responsive. Thanks to this kind of newfound responsiveness and the change in the control scheme, I was actually able to take all of this a step further and have the canoe propel forward and turn in the opposite direction of the stroke whenever the paddle is in the water, meaning that you're actually controlling the canoe movement in a realistic way. So if you have a long, steady paddle stroke on the left side, but a short, abrupt paddle stroke on the right side, then you're actually going to start drifting the canoe because of the way that the propulsion is actually simulating in a realistic manner. Similarly, if you're rapidly spamming input from side to side, then you're not going to move very efficiently, potentially not even at all if you're really spamming it back and forth. So obviously I'm not trying to make a hyper-realistic canoeing simulator, but I have to say that it genuinely feels like you're canoeing now, and it's a lot of fun. The canoe sections of the game are actually much more enjoyable now, and it allows for some real skill in the input to get around most efficiently, which is great. You can also see in this kind of behind-the-scenes look at how I'm determining where the paddle is making contact with the water. This is used not just to propel the canoe forward, but also to place the particle systems and sound effects at the exact point of contact between the blade or shaft and the water, which helps improve the tactile feel of canoeing. There's still some work to do on improving the canoe animations, I'll grant that, particularly with more forward and side-to-side rotation to emphasize the effort, but overall I feel like the canoe system is finally in a good place and ready for some playtesting, so that's a great milestone. So let me know down below what you think of the new canoe system. I'm really excited about it, but I'm also keen to hear your thoughts as well. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe, and consider wishlisting the game on Steam, that really helps a ton. In any case, I'll see you in the next one, bye for now!